the people you have on your screen here, Andrew Carnegie on the left, John D. Rockefeller on the right, two of the richest humans to ever live on the face of planet Earth. And they did it through business. So why didn't people get rich before? Well, people were rich before, but these guys figured out how to do it better. One reason they figured out how to do it better is they used something called vertical integration. Now, they controlled every aspect of production of a good. So in this chart here, you have something like Rockefeller used. He owned the oil wells. So at the bottom, he owns all the oil wells, which gets the raw materials. He's pumping oil out of the ground. He owns everything that transports the oil. So you have pipelines. You also have wagons full of oil, which is number two. You have processing. You have to transform that oil into something humans can use. So like kerosene, or it's going to be some sort of oil you're going to use to lubricate machines. The finished product. You have to get the kerosene out there to people. He owns all of that. So the railroads, he owns. He also owns every store that is selling this to the consumers. So from the beginning of oil being pulled from the ground all the way to you buying kerosene to light your lamps, John D. Rockefeller owned. This is called vertical integration. You own every aspect of production. And when you can own all of it, well, you're going to start making a lot of money because you don't have to pay other companies to do it. Also, you start having corporations. So while you're making so much money already, you also have shareholders. You're allowing people to buy stocks in your company, to buy a portion of your company. Now, with that money that people are giving you, that are investing in your company, you can invest it into more factories. You can invest it into more workers, more exploration, and really expand your company, which gives shareholders, if you expand your company, make it worth more, shareholders, their investment goes up. So this is one of the first times that you have a lot of people buying shares, and you have these corporations coming up. So shareholders invest. A board of directors is elected by the shareholders who are going to be managing the company. The board of directors hires a CEO who is the overall in charge. CEO hires executives like the CFO, the chief financial officer, a vice president, those sorts of things, and those people hire workers. So this is a corporation, and corporations become the norm. Now, while there's many of these companies, you have oil, steel, the railroad corporations. They're these massive conglomerates that control, at this time, mostly one aspect of business. So you don't have multiple oil companies, you don't have multiple steel companies, you have one. So they don't have much competition. However, when there is some sort of competition, well, what's known as a pool arises. A pool is when you have multiple companies that sell the same good, and instead of trying to compete with each other, they set the prices of that good. So imagine all of us, we are all selling bicycles. Instead of us competing and selling bicycles at different prices, well, we're all going to agree to sell bicycles at the same price, which hurts the consumers, because instead of us competing and trying to lower our prices, we all agree on a high price. So we all make money. So pools, now it's quite illegal, but at the time, pools were a great way for companies to produce goods and not have to compete, and everyone got rich. Now, one man who got rich, well, his name was Andrew Carnegie. This is Andrew Carnegie in his later years. He was from Scotland, and he came over to the United States and got involved with steel. Now, Carnegie started pretty low on the rung and worked his way up. Started owning many steel factories, steel mills, and he once again owned all levels of production. So you see barges, he owns all those that are transporting things like coal, that raw iron, and the finished products. And remember, they're using the Bessemer process, which is pumping oxygen, air, into molten iron, which creates steel. So Carnegie Steel was massive. He made over $300 billion. Now, I think the richest person on Earth today is worth $70 billion. Carnegie, $300 billion. This is a piece of steel on a bridge. It's in Ohio. So you still have large structures built with Carnegie steel all over the country. Now, Carnegie, he was responsible for a fairly devastating flood. A dam that his club, he was part of an exclusive club, built. It broke, even though against all warnings, and destroyed a town in Pennsylvania. He felt so bad that of all the people that were killed and lives destroyed and homes very much knocked down, that he started donating a lot of his money. He's one of the first big philanthropists. And he builds libraries, public libraries all over the country. He doesn't want to give his money to people and try to prop themselves up. He wants them to, look, here's books to read. You can better yourselves. So he very much believes if people work hard, they can achieve anything. He started out very low means and became, one of the second richest men in the world. And to give back to the people, he built libraries. This is a library in Rockport, Massachusetts. He built hundreds of libraries all over the country. Yes, he was the second richest man. The first richest man. Alright, so there was one man that was richer than Andrew Carnegie, and that man would be John D. Rockefeller. Now, John D. Rockefeller, he made his money through oil and the railroads. He was what's known as a robber baron. Rockefeller owned virtually every oil production in the country and controlled every aspect of production, had vertical integration. He garnered a lot of criticism because he made massive profits and paid his workers very small wages. And this image here, a cartoon from the time, shows this man with a massive crown and the railroads and oil sit upon his head made of gold. He certainly did donate a large amount of his money. He donated money to start University of Chicago. You have Rockefeller Center in New York City. But he was worth, some believe, $600+ billion, which is a staggering figure. So you have people like Rockefeller and Carnegie making massive profits, and the normal people, the normal workers who they're making money on, well, they're not really seeing much of it at all.